So welcome to this masterclass. We'll be talking about nonfiction, reportage, creative nonfiction, and writing. I am Beverly Ochieng. I've been working with BBC Monitoring, which is a part of the BBC, since the start of 2018. I do analysis, a lot of writing, a lot of research, covering mostly sub-Saharan Africa. I know people tend to find sub-Saharan Africa slightly, but it's because we'd be looking at everything south of Mauritania, including Sudan. And this is Mercy Juma, who has been having a very chaotic week. Tell us about it.
Yes, straight from the streets to the Literature Festival. Yes, so my name is Mercy Juma. A journalist, definitely by profession. I work for the BBC and I'm the East Africa correspondent for the BBC. So that's my JD, but I'm based here in Nairobi, but I cover a lot of the region. So I get a lot of assignments all across Africa. The last 2 years, I've been doing a lot of conflict and conflict setting reporting and post-conflict societies as well. Before the BBC, I was at NTV. This is my sixth year at the BBC. And yeah, I'm so happy to have you guys here. And yeah, looking forward to how this goes.
Yeah. So I thought, as part of the introduction, obviously your names, what you do, but I would love to know, what is a piece of writing or a book that you have read in the last couple of years that you think has made an impact on you? So just briefly.
Hello, my name is Dennis. I'm a writer and an editor. And the books, okay, there's a number of books, but let me just probably mention two. The most recent book I read, which was such a glorious book, I recommend it to everyone. It's a book called The Most Secret Memory of Men. It's a fiction book by Mohamed Mbougassa, a Senegalese writer who writes really well. So I really like his book. And then the other book is, it's actually four books in part, but of course it's, I think I could use this one. It's Elena Ferrante's My Brilliant Friend. Yes.
Hi everyone.
Hi.
My name is Celine Ocharo. I am a psychologist. And a book I have read recently is Things They Lost by Okwirio Duor. It's a fiction story and it's amazing. I read that book twice. I read it the first time, then I was like, no, I have to read it again. And also I stumbled upon Biko's writing, Jackson Biko, and yeah, everything Biko is cool.
Hi everyone.
Hi.
My name is Nomakawe Joho. I am a freelance writer, but a doctor by training. What I read recently, I think I'll cheat and talk about the articles we read for the masterclass. The article on the female athletes being murdered I didn't even know that was a thing. So I was reading out of amazement, but also it was very well written. I enjoyed the article, but I was amazed that something can happen here and I didn't know anything about it.
Hi, everyone.
Hi.
Yes, I'm Clinton Otieno, a librarian by profession. I've not read that so much fiction. Yes, it is like I'm new in this now. Mm-hmm. Yes, it is a new environment for me. Yes, thank you.
That's quite a range, obviously, which is good. And even just being able to see where it is that stories do come out. It could be a story about a region you know, like living in Kenya, and then you see it being published by someone else. And I thought one of the reasons I wanted to share the variety of pieces is to see how it works when it's in the news, which is the sum of the BBC articles, but also how it works in other places where they publish longer fiction or longer nonfiction. Local magazines are not as many, and I think one of the biggest frustrations, even with writers who I know, is they don't get space to be able to expound on something for a long time or obsess over a topic for a long time. But this would be a good space to be able to talk about, what is your own exposure to nonfiction, to creative nonfiction, to reportage? What do you want to do with it? How do you structure it? How do you work with it? And how these examples are sort of different ways of thinking about voice, narrative, people. How do you put in factual accounts? Because the most boring part about it is when you have to put the facts in and the research that goes into that, and how do you attribute it? So from reading these, what do you think goes into a good nonfiction piece? it's not a test, not like you'll be scored or penalized or anything. It's very open. But what do you think are the elements that go into a very good written piece?
Research.
Sorry?
Research.
Yes.
Lots and lots of research.
Money? Oh, wow.
Yes, money.
Money.
Observation, definitely. I would say time. Just time to be able to get something right. And sometimes I think the balance between, because you've done a lot of breaking news, I tend to have a lot more time to think about things. But the balance between when you need to do something in the now and then when you need to now build something that resonates with people for a very long time. Many of these are, so the ones I sent, those one from Granta about what the Wagner Group is doing. That's one thing I've been very obsessed with. Russian mercenaries on the continent. And then there's the one for the athletes, the female athletes who have been, you know, killed and the circumstances under which that has happened. And then there was the one which you'd worked on, Mercy, looking at what famine is doing for people who are trying to flee from the conflict in Sudan. And then recently, or what's happening now, the protests in Kenya. So that balance between what do you talk about the now events, and then how do you build a human picture so that people can feel like they connect to them? I think I wanted you to come in and talk about how you were able to do that with Sudan.
All right. Yeah, I think telling a non-fiction story, or rather telling news, is, for me, it's like a journey. You know, you just don't, and almost like a never-ending journey, especially when you're talking about things like Sudan, conflicts that are going on and on and on, and today there is really no end in sight to the crisis in Sudan. But it started somewhere, and on the day that it started, when it broke in April 15th of last year, you know, when there was news that there's renewed fighting in Sudan, the two generals are fighting, then that becomes like breaking news. And here, most of the time, we're just dealing with the facts, you know? Who, like, you know, your five W's and H? Yeah, the five W's and H, by the way, they follow you everywhere. The five W's and H follow you everywhere. So, like, when Sudan was breaking, it was about the five W's and H, basically just telling people out there what's happening. But after day one of reporting about fighting has broken in Sudan, X number of people have been killed, this is what is happening, then you need to move the story forward. And we now start talking about day two, we start talking about week two, we start talking about 1 month of fighting, we start going into the first anniversary in April this year, we did 1 year of fighting. And all this time, you must find new stories to tell, yeah? You must continue giving your audiences the snippets of what is happening there. And this was really tricky, and still is really tricky for us as journalists because of how hard it is to get into Sudan. Up to today, we are not able to get into Sudan. I know there are a couple of journalists, including one of our own from the BBC, who've been able to go in, but it's very limited. It's not a free space for media to operate. So most of how we've been doing it is from the peripheries. For me, from Chad, reporting about Sudan from Chad and from here in Nairobi. So moving from the five W's and H, which you also have to maintain even as you do your week one and month one and month, whatever, six and 1 year of reporting. But then you now have to start really widening the scope of your storytelling. For example, we now start looking at the survivors. We're now start looking at, you know, the people who've been, who fled their homes, the refugees. We now have to start looking for sources inside the country who can help us tell the story from outside the country. We now start looking at things like the allegations of rape, which are not really allegations, but, you know, the rape, the sexual violence that has been happening. We look at the events that are now affecting other regions, and now we start roping in other countries. What is happening in Ethiopia, where some of the refugees are fleeing into, what is happening in like South Sudan. So in a nutshell, a story really never dies until you decide it's time. There will always be new ways to tell a story and to transform a story from a purely news story to a feature story, which is like what, like the farmer in peace. It's really not a new story, it's a feature story, but it started from a new story of the five W's and H, who is fighting, what is happening, and this is what we know. So, yeah, we will always have to tell this story about Sudan until that day when we say, oh, probably And I hope that day comes, the two generals have decided to have a peace talk. There's no more fighting, there's ceasefire, you know. But even after that ceasefire, we'll still have to go into Sudan and tell the story of, you know, the rebuilding and all that.
As, you know, writers yourselves, what are some of the big things you struggle with? And maybe we can try to think of how do we help you think through that. So what do you think is your biggest struggle, for instance, when you're writing?
Interviewing people, like just trying, having that, looking at who to interview, approaching them. I think that that's really a big stumbling block for me.
On my part, I could say emotional bias. Because, for example, if it's a story that's touching on, let's say, something like rape or gender war or anything of that sort, how would you write without leaning onto this part where you want to demonize the perpetrator of the violence?
I think my struggle being African is I feel like our nonfiction is not just depression. Like, it's not always sadness. Yeah. I mean, if I wrote a story about me and my friends in Nairobi, that's still nonfiction, even though we don't really have any of these kind of things happening in our lives. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's mostly my struggle, looking for angles that can still make sense and be newsworthy, but it's not sadness.
Mm. On my side, I think of language. It might be a challenge, maybe.
Like language in terms of the one you choose to write with or translating or?
Yeah, you love to get the translators.
For example, if you have to work in a country that doesn't speak, where English or Swahili is not their primary language, right?
Like, for instance, in Sudan, I think they don't speak much of English.
Yeah, no. It's Arabic.
Arabic.
Yeah. So that might be a very big challenge.
Okay.
I mean, I talk on the bit about language because the service I work with, we work with local languages and then have to translate them into English for the most part for other people to access. So one thing is building a strong network of people who are able to translate or work in both languages or work in a language that is sort of an intermediary. So one example I can give is like in Mali, the lingua franca is Bambara. Most people would probably be using that into French, which most of us might have, and then you translate that into English. And I think language shouldn't necessarily have to be a barrier because I think more and more people are trying to write things in local languages. And I think even having nonfiction in lengthy local languages is liberating because it means that the people from that region are able to access it. The language services of the BBC have been doing that. If it's Igbo, Yoruba, Swahili, Hausa, and so on and so forth. And I think more and more platforms are trying to create space to make sure that those languages can be properly transliterated even on a website. Because there's also the thing about accents and you know, figures and things like that. So that shouldn't be the big thing. But when you build networks of people who you feel you can trust, it could be journalists, they could be translators, they could be writers themselves, they could be other types of correspondents, and then you're able to transliterate that, but also keep it in their own language, because I'm sure their own audiences would also be interested in being able to see themselves being fleshed out in a language that they understand.
When it comes to interviewing, what do you struggle with? Is it the people to interview, or how to do the interview, or what? Because those are the two main things that I would pick out that would give you a challenge, which or both of them?
I think both of them, because whenever I try to write, whenever I try to write a story, I'm always biased towards writing personal essays. But I really want to move from just writing about personal essays mm-hmm. into things which incorporate people who are other than me, mm-hmm. So that maybe my stories will be richer and they can include a better. Yeah. Better angles, not better angles, but other perspectives, okay. I think. Yeah. So I think everything with interviewing as opposed to nothing.
Aspects. All right. So I think when you talk about the people in relation to interviewing, then for us from the news side, this is where we talk about sources, you know, like the people you talk to, the broad name is sources. And there is no story without people. Rarely do we have a story without people. And it starts, for me, I would say it starts with networking, making the networks, going out, talking to people, reaching out to other writers. Who do they talk to? I saw you wrote about this person. Can you give me their contact? Can you help me reach out to this person? And sources are not a one-day thing. You just don't wake up one day and you've built a really strong base of sources. It takes time, it takes effort, it takes a lot of continuity in your relationship. And again, here is where I say, when it comes to sources or the people you look for interviews, for information, who are, you know, senseis in specific subjects. For example, you would want to speak to a doctor when you're talking about something medical. If it's something about mental health issues, you would want to talk to a psychiatrist. So basically, I'm just telling you, you have a psychiatrist, you have a doctor's ear, exchange contact. If you ever are writing a medical piece on, yeah, they would point you to the people. But one thing that is very important when it comes to reportage, or even for me, news reporting, is the relationship that you cultivate and you maintain with your sources, with your news sources, yeah? For example, I'll use Sudan as an example. When fighting broke in Sudan and things got really bad in Darfur, one of my main sources was a local man who somebody gave me their contact, and I reached out on WhatsApp and he kept updating me and helped me do my first text piece for BBC Online. So he was in Darfur, but he kept feeding information, you know? When RSF attacked his town, he had to flee into Chad, right? He lost his phone and we lost contact after a while. But I still kept sending the messages and kept checking on him. I was like, hey, are you okay? He never responded to my messages, but I kept, you know? So there's also that bit of making people not feel used. Yeah? That you give me a story and that's it. Especially when it's in really fragile setting. There's that thing about relationship. I kept reaching to this guy. The first time I went to Chad, I met him. He wasn't one of my interviewees. I wasn't going there to interview him. But when he told me, oh, I'm here, and I had a stopover at the airport, he came all the way to the airport and we met at the airport. And I still kept on, and he's still been feeding me information. He now wants to move into Egypt. I am not getting anything from him, but I want him to know that I was not just there for him to feed me for the first few months that he was in Sudan, and then that's it. So it's about cultivating a relationship. Even if we don't talk for 2 months, I can still go back and say, hey, there's this thing that is happening. Are you able to point me to the correct people to speak about? And who'll be able to do that? But if I only spoke to him on 15th of April, and then I now reach out again, asking for another lead 6 months later, you know, it just doesn't seem right. So when it comes to sources, it's about establishing that connection, establishing that relationship, and maintaining it, yeah? And maintaining it, yeah. In terms of the interview questions, I think we were supposed to talk about research and planning, okay. And that will come later, and probably that's where I will address what really goes into, you know, your interview questions based on what you are asking for. But I am from the point of, or my opinion is that if you have done your research and if you have, basically if you've done your research and planned well, you should not struggle with your interview questions. You only struggle with your interview questions when you don't have a good base, a good foundation, and that is research. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think it goes back to, so that's the thing you asked about, emotional bias, and that building an emotional connection with someone, it doesn't go away, because if you're dealing with a story where you're dealing with a human being and circumstances, sad, good, whatever it is, you will have your feelings, but you have to have things that guide you through being objective when you're telling the story. It could be about violence against women, it could be about a night out and having had a party, but you always have to have the things that you grasp on that then guide you to be able to still tell the story as objectively as possible. One thing is obviously with the language that you choose to use, think about what the person is telling you. Think about how you would want to portray it as objectively as possible. Think about the context and the background with which this person is telling you that story, because that can also sometimes color one's judgment, how you're working, your own working conditions. When it's particularly emotive, yes, it's very easy to be sucked in. I think there's things that I've covered from a distance, and that distance sometimes allows me to be objective, but also the understanding that it's something that could be impacting people. It could be the situation in DR Congo. It could be, you know, what are young people doing in West Africa on social media, which has been one of my big fascinations. But it's also about looking at the well-rounded, what is the political, social, economic circumstances with which something is happening. And then we'll sort of talk about attribution and sources, because that's one thing that allows you to build not just the research, but also the backing with which you're able to say something in an impartial way, which is the word that we'd normally use.
If I am assigned a story, if you are going out to do a story and you feel conflicted, you feel you are not going to be biased, and we definitely have those stories that we know we are not going to be biased. We are going to be biased. For example, you are writing a piece about some burglary that has happened somewhere, and one of the burglars, God forbid, was your brother. Would you report on that? Do you think you'll be 100% not biased?
I think it depends how I choose to tell the story. I think if you're telling it in a formal setting, then you'd have to think about it better. But if it's like an informal sort of like a social media story, you could be like, guys, my brother's a burglar. This is what I found out. And then you put it in context and you mm-hmm. can carry on sort of the non-formalness mm-hmm. of it. But if I've written it really as like a BBC story, then mm-hmm. It would be harder for me.
Please remember that as a BBC reporter, the BBC you on screen is the same as the BBC you on social media. So you cannot go on screen or online and say, my brother didn't do this,
no,
or my brother did it.
Like if it's your personal blog kind of thing.
Even
like
if...
completely informal, not a...
You still, if you work for the BBC or any news organization, you cannot run a personal blog that is saying something different on a news story than what you said on... For example, I could run a personal blog right now, but I cannot go on that protest and start Ruto must go. Because you will see it and see I'm a BBC reporter, and definitely the assumption will be that is the BBC's position. So that's why I'm saying then conflict of interest comes here. You should be able to say, no, I cannot do this story because I feel I will be biased. I cannot do this story because my sister is in that story, because my best friend is among those people accused, and you should be excused. Your employer should be able to say, okay, so that the face of the news organization or the media that you are representing remains as factual as possible. So when you feel too emotional, too attached to something, then you go back and look at something called conflict interest, and then you weigh, will I do justice to this story? Will I give the people justice if I tell this story and I feel this, you know? Yeah.
So I guess we can do one short exercise where you'd be able to test out how you would write the opening paragraph, 100 or 150 words of a situation. So I'll just say it at least twice that you all get it, and then we'll give you like 10 minutes to just write that out. Then you can each read out what you've written or what you managed to put together. So it's the onset of the rainy season. You find yourself in Maimahiu. You could be visiting family, friends, but you're a journalist, you're working there, and you hear of an incident where a bridge has been cut off and there's a bus that sort of drove off and they're trying to rescue about 60 children from that. What would your opening line entail? This is just a short feature piece to look at what the rainfall is doing for people living in that area. Do I repeat it again? So it's the onset of the rainy season and you happen to be in Maimahiu. So there's a bridge that's been cut off and a bus has driven off and they're trying to rescue about 60 children from that bus. What would your first couple of 100 or 150 words be of that story?
So there's rains, there's a bridge, and there's a bus with 60 children. It rained heavily and the bus was going to wherever, but it was swept away. Rescue efforts are ongoing. Write a piece. Just two paragraphs.
Just write the intro.
How would you write it out? How would you describe that? How would you set it up for a reader?
As a news piece. Yeah?
Yeah.
News piece?
Could be a news or feature piece. Sort of
whichever.
Feature-ish. Yeah. How was that for everyone?
Yeah?
Is that with you, Clinton? How was that?
Okay. Mine, I've done like a reporting.
Yeah, it's fine.
Okay.
It's free.
Thank you so much. This is the story. There has been a heavy downpour in some parts of Kenya, Rift Valley region to be precise. The rain, which started 24 hours ago, has so far claimed a life of over 50 people, including the children. The bridge which connects two rivers has also been swept away, and search and rescue operations are underway. This was according to the sources on the ground. Some, according to the residents, claim that the rain has so far claimed the life of many, in that they cannot locate some of their relatives since the rain started.
Okay.
Oh, yeah,
okay, well done.
The rainy season is upon us and has brought with it both blessings and misfortune. In regards to the latter, a bridge in Maimahiu, regularly used by the locals to connect them to different parts of the town, has been cut off by raging water currents. A bus transporting about 60 school-going children has been swept up. Okay, has been swept up by the water currents. Search and rescue operations are underway to retrieve the occupants of the vehicle.
Good stuff.
Just start.
The rains in Maimahiu this season have been very strong. Unfortunately, this has led to a bridge collapsing. A bus with about 60 children on board. To assist, rescue efforts have been sent out to commence looking for survivors. Maimahiu is in the Rift Valley region. And then I had put that I'll proceed maybe to talk about the bridge and maybe to talk about the bus. Was it a public school bus or was it a certain school? Yeah.
On my first day in Maimahiu, the rains fell heavily, washing over a bridge, and with it, a school bus that was carrying about 60 children. Our driver parked beside the road, and we got out to help with the rescue efforts which are underway. Most of the rescuers were local men, many of them pedestrians passing by before the tragedy occurred. I could see the bus in the middle of the river, turned over on its side. One of the men was standing over it, trying to reach into the window and retrieving a terrified 10-year-old child. Yeah, so
So I guess you can see how one incident can give, you know, very different responses. Mm. There's nothing wrong or right about it.
Yes.
It's just about perspective and how you write it from. Of course, when you're working with different either media organizations or publications, they'll have what they call a house style, where there might be a way you write numbers, a way you might write an intro, how long something should be. I think in journalism, intros are supposed to be like not more than 25 words.
Yeah.
I tend to do like 40 or 50 because I'm always packing things. But also I'm doing a different type of writing. There's the thing about, you know, the four W's and the five W's and the H, which sort of have to go in. So when something happened, who was involved, you know, what is it, how it happened. Those are things that still are, you know, you've already been able to see that there. And also it brings me to now the pieces of writing that I'd sent you, because there are varied types of reporting. Some are straight up news reports, so they start off with straight up news reports. Some are narrative journalism. And a story like this can work both as a straight up news report. 60 kids have, you know, in a bus, there's been rains in Maimahiu, this is what's happening in the situation. Or it can be a narrative piece, an eyewitness account. It could be you're living in a place and you've never seen such a devastating tragedy. So like the ones I want to talk about is, so the one which you'd mentioned about the female athlete, when you look at the introduction, it starts off with a news piece of there had been a period where there was femicide. It became quite a big topic. And this was one entry point for this person. She wanted to look at it from the perspective of women who are very well known in the athletic scene. And that first line is not a conventional news story, although it is pinned from a news story. When Agnes Tirop was 11, she was already as fast as athletes twice her age. She loved running and she shined. That's where she brings in the witness account or a person who knew her. The thing about how do you bring in an interview, how do you bring in another person to feel in the story. Tirop, who was born in 1995, was small-boned, delicate-featured, with cropped hair. Even as a child, she was self-possessed with a singular focus on improving her speed. So you're focusing on the person in the story. You're able to give a physical description. You're able to get in a quote from someone who knew that person, which still brings in the emotive value of the story. It's a family member. It's not biased. It's quite plain and simple. And obviously the story is quite tragic because we know she died and the circumstances in which that happened. But you're still able to build all of those little elements. And that's the thing about storytelling. You have your event, because always we're drawn to a story because of a person or a thing that has happened. What are all of the little elements you bring in to be able to now bring that event to life for a reader? What is the choice of narrative? Where are you doing it? News is always very straight. So if you look at the one on the protests, Kenya's president humbling shows power of African youth. This, I think, was published a day after the protest and when, you know, the president had said he would withdraw his budget. So that first line is very pinned to that. The events that led William Ruto to abandon his budget might in time be seen as a milestone moment. So the news event is that he abandoned the budget, but it's pinned to what the protests were and what it means. And you can always do something like that. It's a story that is also quite emotional if you are a Kenyan, but there's a way to still talk about it without seeming either biased or without seeming like you're taking a particular side or you're maligning someone else or anything of the sort. So it's really about how you choose your words and how you choose to be able to build that. And then even coming to the one about Sudan, which starts off with, civilians caught up in Sudan's civil war have given graphic accounts to the BBC of rape, ethnic violence, and street executions. It's quite a bleak intro, but it kind of succinctly puts what it is we would expect from the article. And even there's a disclaimer at the end where it says, This will have accounts of physical sexual violence. It's also good to do that for readers because then it lets them prepare themselves mentally for possibly what might be very, you know, disturbing accounts. And there's an attribution there. You can see one of the worst humanitarian nightmares in recent history, which is from the UN. So sometimes you have to think about when you are doing part of the research, which, you know, Mercy will talk about, and when you're attributing, which is the thing that I want to get into, when is the right place to be able to bring that in? Your voice is driving the narrative. It's the one that will give you your opening lines. It'll give you your, you know, how you build the details and facts. Who you speak to is now what gives the robustness to that piece, is what is able to give in the different voices and perspectives. So you could choose to speak to an eyewitness who will tell you the terror of the child who was being pulled out of the bus. That is already enough in itself. You could describe what the rainfall was like, over how many days it was taking place, or even what you're thinking about going into the details of what is the school, who was it, do you speak to a school official, how do you attribute what they have said. You look for the sort of powerful quotes, because the other thing you're trying to do is, you start off with those first lines, a school bus has been swept away, and then you want things that support the rest of the story. Maybe a meteorologist said, I never can say that word. Guys who do weather. They might say something like, this has been the worst period of rainfall. And you want to be able to put that somewhere in there because then it's able to show you the extent of the tragedy. Or this is the biggest number of people we've seen attending this thing. And then you're able to put that somewhere and you're able to show the height of excitement of something. So there's always those choices that you make that are deliberate. And with all these pieces, you're able to see that. The one from Granta, which I picked on the Wagner Group. I mean, I've been struggling to write about the Wagner Group, but I did like that line. You know, I was always confused about where people left their guns. And that sort of drives you in of why do people here have their guns? You can choose to do something like that, which builds suspense. Then you put in the context, the background. This is where I am. This is the atmosphere around me. The air is thick. You know, there's torrential rainfall. I could feel the water underneath my feet. Think about all of those little details and the way you're able to sort of just bring them to life into your story is probably the most important thing.
An event could bring out very different stories and very different ways of storytelling, you know. For example, you introduced Rift Valley and where it is. So you took us to Rift Valley. He chose to go with his own account that could go on a blog, that could go on a tweet, that could go on social media. So bottom line is, reportage, nonfiction doesn't have to be, the style doesn't have to be cast on stone. Some people choose it to be thematic. Some people choose it to be chronological. Some people, you know, everybody writes it in a way that they feel appeals to their audience. And again, here, you have to be very careful. Who are you writing it for? You know, what is your audience? What is the key message that you want to pass around? Do you want to talk about, is your main focus the rains and how heavy they are? Climate change? Do you want to use that to talk about climate change because my Mahi never gets heavy rainfall at this time? Thematic. Do you want to talk about Kenyan roads because that place is very slippery, there's a lot of hot potholes, the tarmac wore off, and so do you want to talk about corruption and how money that was supposed to build? Exactly. Yeah, exactly. You see, so you can choose very many things to tell, and you can write very many different pieces just from one event. It's you to decide how you want to tell it and who you are basically telling it for. If I was doing it, I would definitely go 60 children, blah blah blah, because that's because I mean I'm writing, yeah, like that's the breaking news for me. 60 children swept away by, I mean, everybody. For us, that's, you know, everybody will be clicking to read that, you know. None of you went that route, and that's okay, because my audience is different from your audience. Yeah, so no wrong or right way to do this. Is about you at the end of the day achieving the goals that you want to with your story. But one thing stands out across all these stories: factual.
Yeah.
Whichever route you check.
Whichever. Just say, 120 children died. No. It's not the fact. The
yes,
fact
they were 16.
All. Like, that's one standard thing about reportage and fiction, is about facts. You cannot change, you cannot bend that. However, whichever way you choose to tell your story, the facts will always remain the same. We all have 60 children in our stories. We all have my Mahi in our stories. We all have, you know, so the facts just cannot change.
Yeah. Any questions from that, though?
You had talked about house guidelines.
Mm-hmm.
So that's about like grammar. It's not about structure of story.
No, I mean, house style is a very, very, it's a very editorial process. So I edit, which is the thing. It could be how you choose to, you use miles instead of kilometers.
Yeah.
It could be that you have
to be like narrative or straight.
No. I mean, if you choose to submit to a narrative journalism magazine, then they would expect a narrative piece. They'll have their own way of maybe rendering Mr. or Mrs.
Yes.
or the name of a place and things like that. So that's a simple editorial thing which you deal with then.
Yeah.
But in terms of the writing and the storytelling, you have that creative liberty. And that's the idea with creative nonfiction. You're dealing with facts, but you're building something about it. So you could choose to focus on all these school kids were caught up in this, you know, weather event. You could choose to make it a climate story. Mm-hmm. You could choose to make it a story about corruption. You could choose to make it about how this region has never experienced this kind of weather event. But they're all valid points. It's just about now, what are the building blocks to that story to be able to now give you that? And that's the creativity bit. That's the research bit.
Yeah.
That's the who you choose to talk to that you think would be able to add into that theme. So if it's going to be a climate story, you may have to talk like farmers in the area.
The
so what is the season normally like? You know, have you lost crops? Or you may have to talk to the weather people and find out what is normally the climatic pattern in this region. You may have to talk to maybe schools about when is the school season, when do you close, open, where were you heading, how did this happen. If it's a corruption story, you talk to officials. How many cases have there been? When was this road constructed? Mm-hmm. Those are now the facts that you get in. And then you weave it in. So even with these stories, you'll see differently. With the athletes, they were talking a lot to the people in that community where Tirop had grown up to get a sense of what is the life of a young girl to a woman like? What are the rates of femicide in Kenya and things like that? Or even with the one about Sudan, the UN reports or the UN officials, people talking about how they're having difficulty getting food. Those are the supporting arguments for your story. I think with any story, you have your what is the event, what is the person, then the building blocks of that. Who are you quoting? Who are you attributing? What is that linear? How do you want to tell it chronologically from the start to the end? Do you want to jump back to 1970 to that one time when it rained very heavily in Maimahiu? And then, you know, it's really your choice how you build that. But as long as you have it to build a complete story. Yeah.
You can even choose to talk to, like for this story, you can decide, I'm going to talk to drivers who use this road every day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's long haul trucking on
my
because it's a thing.
Or you choose to talk to somebody who's lived along that road, who's built their home not far from there, and they've lived there for the last 30 years. How is it like every day seeing, you know, buses, cars, trucks driving down this road? So literally you choose your own narrative and how you want to tell it, again, depending on how it will appeal to your audience. But the best line, again, is just the facts. As long as you keep the facts, you can tell your story whichever way. You can choose to talk to very, you know, different people. He can choose to talk to the area police boss. And then you say, no, I'll go to the hospital and talk to the nurses or the medical superintendent. And then he will say, no, I'll talk to the teachers because they're the ones who were the students, you know? So everybody chooses the direction that their story tell. And that's how one story done by 10 media houses, 20 blogs, and 50 other different people will have different accounts, will give you different things, but the same fact. Yeah.
I have a question. When you mentioned something about editorial styles or media styles, something like that, something popped up. It's like there's this thing about, it's more or less about words and what they mean. Say, like, something has happened, like, say, I think it was 2 days ago, where a protester was shot, and then a media house was like, this person was allegedly shot, but then the person has already been shot. So I don't know, how does that work? Like, what's the guideline, or what's the... Because I find it very challenging whenever, like, even with the abductions. You have the video, but someone still says he was allegedly abducted.
I guess because there's always this, with news especially, there's always this tendency towards official reporting.
Yes.
And when it's been officially said, even if you know, especially in some countries, you know, like I cover the Sahel a lot, whatever they say is often a claim, you're never quite sure about it, but because it's coming from the person who's supposed to be the official of the country, you take it as the fact. And it's never always a protection, because you can still be sued no matter what it is, even if said allegedly, even if said claimed. It's never the full protection, but it kind of allows you to still retain that level of objectivity. You will talk to the victims' families, and sometimes that's the other way of sort of adding into that account. So in the initial, you know, on the onset, when something happens, it's still an allegation. You're still trying to get clarity. Then you might get a family member who will say, this is what happened. So you add that in. Then you get an official who would then confirm that XYZ number of people were injured or shot at, or confirming this and confirming that. With news, it's much more difficult. With reportage and longer investigations, and I think there's stuff like BBC Africa Eye and The Eye that do that, they'd be able to go into now verifying and being able to give you a sense of it really did happen. But in those initial moments, because there's often so much anxiety about what the facts are, who is saying it, how do we attribute it, which is the thing about attribution again. A victim may say something, but you still have to take it with caution because it has to come from somewhere. If there's a court proceeding that needs to take place, so someone could say that they have been assaulted by someone, and you have their account. And that goes back to the whole thing about emotions as well. And it could be something that's very close to you. It could be they were physically assaulted or sexually assaulted, or something happened to them, they had an accident. And then is there a police record of it? And maybe the police would say, yes, they filed this thing, blah, blah, blah. Then there's a court process, and maybe the court process has to now determine the outcome. Then is when you can say, this person was hit by this person, or this person was... but before that, with news and with media, it tends to be a bit more... with a bit more caution. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just about attribution, basically. For example, for the protests that we've been covering, the figures about those who were killed are varied, yeah?
Yeah.
I cannot go on air and say 50 people were killed, yeah? According to who? Yeah? So I have to say, human rights organizations say that, or there are varied reports about how many were killed during the protest on Tuesday. One human rights organization say there are 23 people, the others who say 30 people killed. So it's about attribution and being careful so that it is not reported, like you are the ones who are giving these final figures. When we use the terms allegedly, it's because we, or I as a journalist, have not been able to confirm that, right? I am on the streets, I'm reporting about the protests, and then I am seeing reports on, even if other media are reporting that somebody has been shot, we say there are reports, you know? So unless you have verified it, yeah, unless you can stand, you know, if somebody asks you, did you, it's like if you, you, that one of, if you did not see it, don't say it, if you did not hear it, don't say it, you know? So unless you can stand and really say, these facts are right because of this, this, and this, then just don't do it, you know? Attribute it to somebody else. It's not really about house style, it's about being ethical and being objective in your reporting. So house style really boils down to things like, you know, when you say Mr. William Ruto, there are others, after the initial introduction, Kenya's president, Mr. William Ruto, others will decide to go with Mr. Ruto, others will decide to go with Ruto, others will go with Mr. William, you know? So when you talk about house style, then those are the things that really come to, you know? House style includes things like how, for example, you write, like, for example, for the BBC, the first number, when you say like nine, you cannot write nine. Yeah. You cannot write nine. You have to write the word nine, yeah? But 13, you cannot write a...
No? Forward 13.
Yes.
So from 10 upwards.
Yes, from 10 upwards, number. You can... But you cannot write 9, you have to write the word 9, you see? So when you talk about house style, that's it. But what you are referring to and all these other things, it's about just ethics as a writer. And most of them are usually very... Like they cut across. The ethical considerations, the writer, they cut across. About accuracy... about, you know, attributing your sources, about not saying things that are not factual, you know, all that stuff. They cut across. They're like standard operating procedures for anybody who is writing nonfiction. Yeah?
In regards to the events in Kenya, sometimes we have, you want to get a story, and they are, I think, there's civil society.
Yes.
The medics, yeah. The hospital where the victims are taken. Mm-hmm. Again, we also have the relatives of the victims, mm-hmm. and the government. Now, these four people, whom do you take the real story from in terms of numbers?
So in terms of numbers, if you would quote whichever. You would say according to, while government says six people were killed, human rights organization or the civil society has recorded, says it has recorded 23. So you have given both. So while the government says this, human rights organizations say 23 people died. However, BBC investigations show that, or 13 or X, you know? So you can put all those figures out there as long as you attribute them. And when later on, like Bev said, investigations now come in handy. For example, maybe two in the next 1 month, somebody will come up with an investigation and say, while the government said six people were killed, we have done our investigations and we've realized that 43 people, God forbid, died in the protest in Nairobi. You know, that comes later. You do your own investigation and you can stand by the facts that you are presenting. If somebody sues you, you can go and say, I talked to this family, I attended this burial, I confirmed that he was shot on 26, he was in the protest and all that, and I attended this 18 burials and they were all in the protests. I have photos to show when they were on the streets. You know, you can stand against, like you can confidently fight for the information that you put there, yeah? So you attribute everyone. While so-and-so says this, these other people say this. Yeah.
Yeah. I think the good thing about nonfiction, especially lengthy writing, is there's always space to put in all of those voices. So then it gives you that range as opposed to, you know, right of reply is always a thing, where you have one account and then you have another account, or you have the other person who is maybe being questioned about what they have to say. But with reportage, you have a lot more room to be able to include those voices. So as much as possible, make them diverse. It also takes you from your own bias, because you might have certain assumptions about things, but it might also help to talk to someone who comes from the opposite side, just to get a sense of their perspective, not necessarily because you're promoting what they have to say, but because it also helps to have that, your own biases, you know, you question them in some ways. So that's another thing to think about.
So the thing about, while we both work for the BBC, how we conduct, like our day-to-day is very different. On-the-day stories, news, and feeding the programs, and, you know, what you see every day on BBC. Bev is the analysis kind of person. She would do the in-depth research,
yeah,
and probably send some of that my way and say, like, this is what I have unearthed, this is what I'm... So it's a symbiotic relationship. We feed off each other, but I think we tend to feed more from you.
Well, I mean, it helps to have that, because I think the tricky thing about writing and about even just working with storytelling is being able to get the right information, where you're getting it from, how reliable is it, and how does it also make your work a bit more wholesome. I mean, we normally see the phrase Githeri Media a lot about how reporting can feel quite shallow, where you're just reacting to something rather than thinking about what are the contexts behind what has happened. So I'd say on an average day, we will be looking for news stories. So like our team is roughly 30 people in-house in Nairobi. Then we have like a whole bunch of freelancers who would be doing things in local languages and sending it to us. Then we would do it in English, which would then feed them. So it's quite a process, quite a chain. On a day-to-day, Monday to Friday, we'd send out a list of what we call prospects. So people would be able to know these are the top stories you need to see from the continent. And then we'd spend the rest of the day either sort of churning out those stories in terms of reading newspapers from all over, as many places as we can. My favorite ones are from West Africa. Looking at radio transcripts. So it's people summarizing what was on the bulletins. It's very mundane sometimes. It could be as boring as last week there were, 5,000 kilograms of maize that was transported from this place to that place. But those things really do feed into something because, for instance, the other day, I think Mali announced that they were going to stop artisanal gold mining. It's not a strange thing. It's the rainy season. And I've seen that over the years where it reaches a point where it's the rainy season. There's been lots of incidents where miners are caught up in very informal mining areas where they're killed because, you know, like it rains, then the mine collapses. So they've stopped that for some time. And over time, you're able to build a pattern from that and say, what is the impact of the rainy season in northern Mali? One of them is that mines tend to collapse. What is the government doing about it? So that's the sort of thing you would see on the surface, but it's a thing that I've probably spent a long time tracking so that I'm able to feed that and it becomes like a news or feature story. And it's also just being deliberate about what are the stories that interest you. I'm interested a lot in security, sometimes in some cultural events, many instances in what people would call global powers are doing in the region. So where is the latest visit by the Russian ambassador? Or they went to this place and they talked to this person and then it becomes something bigger over time. And because I have the time to sit and obsess over those things, it means that I'm able to build something that's a bit like a stronger narrative around it. It takes a lot of patience. One of the things that I've said on and off is I've been trying to track these mercenaries who've been working in Central and West Africa for the last 5 years, I think. And it's been a mixture of things. It's not just what they're doing, but it's what they're doing on social media, which I think is fascinating. It's what they're doing when they talk to people. It's how they appear in the news. And that allows me to have a sort of whole story about what I could say about them. So it could either be a feature, it could be a documentary, it could be a written piece, it could be a short interview. And I have the options to do it in all of those ways because then I've been able to learn about them. So one of the things about writing is you have to be very patient. It won't always come like this. It won't always be easily understood. You won't always get the nugget at that moment, but there'll be a point where you look and you think this is an anniversary that's important. This is a visit that I think is important, or this is an event that I think is fascinating. And all of that research that I've been doing, it feeds into now what she would be doing.
Yeah, so research, basically different people have a different way of doing research. For example, the way Bev does research, you know, reading extensive, you know, newspapers, articles, listening into radios, downloading transcripts and goes through them. It's not essentially the way I do research, right? Because my research involves, like on a typical story, we'll be talking to people, talking to sources, making calls, really like what we would do when you're doing that bus thing, you know, those are the risks. I would be looking at the police. Do I call the police? I need to call the maintenance department. I need to talk to the driver of the bus if they survived and stuff like that. So different writers would do their research differently. If you are writing for something that is not news, or maybe for your blog, you know, you would talk to your friends, you would go online, right? You'd probably go to a library and read books that other people have written, or you'll go to other people's blogs, right? And read what they have written. So people will do their research differently, but the bottom line or the goal is to draw or to come to conclusions, right? But another thing, I talked about facts when it comes to nonfiction and reportage, and facts being a common denominator. When it comes to research, whichever kind of writing you are doing, I think for me, you know, like relevance is a common denominator now, you know? Like it has to make sense. Relevance is a common denominator. And that aside, let me write this down. It's about verification. And I like using this. I call it CRAP with a double A. It's an acronym. It's CRAP. Please, CRAP, not CRAP. CRAP with a double A. So, and it's basically stands for the things that I would check or really use when I'm doing my research, when I'm evaluating and doing my analysis, who I talk to, the sources that I talk to. These are a constant for me, and they are currency, so currency, relevance, authority, accuracy, and purpose. Like that, you have to tick those boxes whenever I'm doing any kind of research. And it's about interrogating your sources. For example, I would get more authority from primary sources. And by primary, do you understand what I mean by primary sources? Primary sources are like, you know, first accounts.
It could be the person who has experienced it.
Yes.
It could be a person who's actually done the research on it. It could be, yeah, that initial being on the ground even.
Yes, or the first publication of a scientific study.
Yeah.
So the first accounts of any event. So primary sources basically would be more accurate for me. Authority, when it comes, like the story that we have done, a figure from... Many people could tell me about the 60 kids on the bus and how many were rescued and how many died, right? Then the person who was behind the bus when they were driving could tell me, oh, 40 of them died, they only rescued 20, right? And then the person with the home nearby would tell me, ah, all of them died, right? And the police, the area police boss, would tell me, we rescued 50, 10 died. Who do I go with? Exactly, authority. The police boss, right? Authority. So those five things, currency, relevance, authority, accuracy, purpose, really feed into how I do my research. And again, when it comes to research, another thing again, and that's why I said we'll talk about interviewing and sources when it comes to these, it's about who serves the purpose that you want to achieve for that story, right? Who serves the purpose? You could have a list of people to interview. They could be 10 or 15, but you need to tell like a 500 word piece, or like for us, for TV news, we only have 2.5 minutes to tell a complete story and make it make sense and still put people's voices in there and put the facts and all that. But I have a list of people to interview. So who among all these people serves the purpose that this piece is intended for, right? Okay. Fact checking, I think we've talked about that. We've handled fact checking and just ensuring that you have accurate accounts, you have accurate figures and all that. Key thing when it comes to even when you are doing your research and reaching out to people and doing interviews, and interviews can either be pre-research or they can either go to the research stage or into the news gathering or writing and editing stage, because we do what are called pre-interviews. Pre-interviews are part of research because sometimes you have to talk to so many people and hear so many narratives before you now go back and say, okay, this one made more sense, so I'm going to now delve more into this. But in all these things, we have things called ethical considerations. For example, seeking consent, and that's what we've done here with you guys, you know. Do I need to seek consent? Who do I need to talk to? You know, respecting things like other ethics. Exactly.
Privacy, protecting your sources, because sometimes if you're doing a very sensitive story, you may really want to get that story out, but is that person safe telling you what they're saying? What kind of protection do you give them? It could be, you know, even how you get those sources is a whole other thing. Don't trick people. I know there's also the work around with tricking people. If you look at investigative, yeah, and payments as well, and investigative reporting. But that's a thing that an editor, any good editor, should be able to guide you with and tell you, okay, we can do this. This is the line we could, you know, potentially cross, but this is not it. But making sure you have the consent of the person you're talking to is really important. And that's a thing you scope in the pre-interview stage. Making sure that if it's a sensitive thing, you know how you'd be able to probably still tell the story and protect them duly and give them the options of, you know, how you could. Is it camouflaging their voice, their face, their name? Is it, you know, certain, not really events. The events themselves still have to be factual. But what liberties can you take with making sure that they can feel safe? Mm-hmm. And I think even the issue about currency is important, because depending on when and what incident took place, you want to know how it feeds into the relevance of your own story at that point.
And another thing, again, when it comes to research is legal considerations, like, you know, privacy, copyright, defamation. You want to ensure that you are not doing anything that is not legal. And for the BBC, we have a legal department, and there are stories that are sent out for people to use, and you see a head, like a warning, this has been ed-polled, that it has gone through editorial policy and legaled. You cannot change even a word, you know, because it has gone through the legal process, you know, because if you change a word and it loses meaning, then that's very prime, you know, ground and prime reason for somebody to sue you. You want to make sure that the kind of writing you do, unless you want to be this controversial writer who wants to, you know, trend and do all that, but you want to make sure that all the writing, any piece that you put out there, is not defaming anyone, is not, you're not infringing on anyone's privacy. You are not infringing on any copyright laws, or, you know, stealing somebody's work and all that. So you want to be make sure that as a writer, you're always on the right side of the law when it comes to these things. And that goes into research. Research, in my opinion, as a storyteller, is like the foundation of good writing. Yeah. It's one of the non-negotiables. If you do not do good research and good planning, there is no way your output can be good, can serve the audiences that you want to. There are times that research involves just sitting down and listening to people, right? Research sometimes involves you going to the salon and just listening to the mamas talking as you get your hair done. Research sometimes involves you going and taking really, like, a lot of time picking the oranges and whatever in the supermarket, because you want to hear what the people are saying. So there are traditional and non-traditional, not so usual ways of doing research. It's very, very varied. It's basically where you will get the information that you're looking for. So don't limit yourself to books, to online sources and all that stuff. You could basically do your research anywhere. And sometimes you actually go in with a blank canvas. For example, I've had to do stories where I go in without any story to tell. For example, with this Sudan story, I have been to Chad twice, right? The first time, there was a lot of research done from the Nairobi office, a lot of talking to sources, like a lot of groundwork done. And when we went in, we knew this is the story we want to tell. These are the people we are going to talk to. And then we come out. Everything planned out, right? But then this war is not stopping, and we still need to tell stories. And we say, okay, you know what? There are these allegations and there is this, but we don't have any concrete leads. Let's just go in. And we go in and you do a lot of snowballing. I talk to Bev. Bev says, I think I know a person who can lead you. And we talk to another. So you spend like the first 4 days literally just looking for that story, talking to people and all that. And that is how we find some of the big stories. You don't have to have everything laid out. Sometimes your instinct tells you there is a story here, and you go and listen and get referrals and all that, and you get your story. Yeah. So as in essence, that's what research, in my opinion, looks like for reportage. Yeah.
Yeah. And it takes a lot of patience.
Oh, honestly. My goodness.
And just, you might have editors who might be, you know, really railing at you. But I think it's about, if you have the conviction that you'll be able to find something and you're using all the right strategies as well, you'll probably likely get something good. And even starting off with nothing or a hypothesis always helps with being able to now build towards that.
Should we do a Q&A?
Or? Yeah, we could do a sort of open Q&A or anything that you think is outstanding that you think you would want us to sort of touch on.
So I have a question. Mm-hmm. There's a scenario where you want to cover a story where some of the people you interview, there's a privacy they require. You get a story where sometimes the voice is not clear and you can't also see the person who's talking. How sure is this person, how assurity will you give this person that he or she will not be shown on the screen? Will he or she watch the event first? It's when it goes online, or how will it happen? How will he or she be sure?
Wow, okay. So when it comes to hiding somebody's identity, it's usually, again, different people have different styles on how they do it. The general rule is always hide any two. And by hide any two is you can hide the face and the name, leave the voice, but sometimes that's tricky because somebody can be identified by their voice, you know, or alter the voice. And, you know, so it's really a tricky situation, but we have what is called duty of care. As a writer, as a reporter, as a journalist, you have duty of care towards your sources. So if you tell somebody you're going to hide their identity and you do not do it, you are not being ethical. You're not being ethical. You're not being truthful, which is one of the core values of a writer. You're not being truthful. And if you do that, definitely you get exposed at some point. You know, you get exposed at some point and it really dents your credibility, your authority as a journalist. So if you tell somebody you're going to hide their identity, you need to do that. Your question is, do we show them how we filmed before? Sometimes we do that. For example, the camera person would be filming and we film in silhouette, and there's a way they can use a code to, like, not really transfer, but simultaneously show their screen on a phone, on a producer's phone, and somebody else, like the father or the mother, would watch it and see, actually, yeah, they are not showing my child's face and all that. Or we would take a photo of that and show the person and say, this is how it looks. Are you happy? Are you comfortable? As a rule, we don't show the end product to the contributor before it goes on air. We generally do not do that because once we have signed consent and we know we need to stick to the ethical considerations, and as a broadcaster, we know how our trust and our credibility is of importance. We make sure we tick all the boxes when it comes to protecting the source. So as long as they are comfortable and we've shown them this is how we are filming, are you okay with that? Then that's it. So at the point of filming, we do that, but not editing the content, then send it to them for approval. We don't do that. But at the point of filming, we ensure they are comfortable with the setup, with how they've been framed and all that. And they give us a go ahead, that's it. Yeah.
I think I have a scenario I had of.
Okay.
There was a story on a local TV station, Citizen. I think the story was, I don't know, last year, but one. It was a story of title, A Guns of Fire. And the reporter, there was a lot of, the government later said that they were not informed of the story. And even the reporter I had disappeared. I had, let me use the term.
Yeah.
Oh, my mouth.
So in that scenario, what do you do?
So
where the government declines.
So here we have something called the right of reply. When you talk about someone or you have accusations about someone, again, you must give them a right of reply. You must reach out and ask, Minister so-and-so, we hear that you took 3,000 or 3 billion US dollars from the county or from the CDF and put it in your account. Or we hear that you've hired everybody from your family. Is this true? They will either say no, they will say no comment, they will refuse to answer, right? You come back again. We are going to publish this article that we have written about allegations of mismanagement of funds in your office. These are the allegations. You took money from the public account. You have hired everybody from your office. Is this true? Do you have a comment? Yes, no, no. If they give you a comment, fine, well and good. They refuse to comment. You send a message on Twitter, because they're active on Twitter, send it on Facebook, send them an email. If you have their phone number, send a message. You have enough proof that you tried to reach out.
Mm.
But you must say, we reached out to government or to so-and-so for comment, but there was no response. And you have proof that you did that, right? But if you really did not reach out to them and there are allegations, then also that is not due diligence on your part as a writer. So right of reply is also very, very important. But like Newton has said, it depends. If it's a publication that maybe we're seeking to put out in a month's time, then there's grace, you know, we give them and we keep reminding them. But if we have 24 hours and if it's a newsy piece, then 24 hours and we go on air and we say we reached out and they no comment.
So about getting into journalism seriously.
Okay. I've, jokingly.
I've been in it in fits and bursts. So if you want to build like a proper career, what's the best approach? Is it sort of like internship and rise or sort of like show and prove? Like you have your portfolio, then you can go somewhere and say, this is what I can do.
I mean, I think it varies. I didn't study journalism. I studied literature. There's always lots of different opportunities. You'll find that there might be media outlets that are advertising for either editors or journalists or reporters or writers. And there's no harm in you applying for it and just trying to show what your level of experience or knowledge is to be able to fit into that role. Just like with any other job, whether you've done any writing, whether you've done any photography, multimedia work, any sort of storytelling. And we do have lots of people, I think in monitoring in particular, we have a lot of what you'd say unconventional background people. We even have an engineer, a doctor, translators, and they get to come in and do a lot of writing. And I think the thing about journalism, in my opinion, is it always helps when you have a whole other background because you see the world in a very different way from when if you're just doing communications as a simple thing. You can also start your own thing. And I think right now there's so much liberty with media. Like everyone is pretty much a journalist. You're on TikTok, you're on Facebook, you're on Instagram, or whatever will be emerging in the next couple of years. And you're able to do some reporting. I guess the tricky thing is how to still maintain objectivity, how to make sure you are able to get an audience's attention without compromising yourself. Because that's a very important thing. There's people who are very sensational online and you'd have to think twice before you say, yeah, we'll give this person a job because, you know, there's things you'll get the training to be able to be empowered to do, whether it's the writing, whether it's learning to be objective, whether it's learning to do your research. That's always there for most media outlets. But I would say start by just writing. It's, you know, it's the easiest way to start off. It could be a blog where you're just documenting life or something unique, a unique topic that you think really interests you. Look out for opportunities, whether it's training, internships, it could be fellowships, it could be a job, a full-on job when you start doing it. And just learn how to use new media because there's lots of threats even to journalism itself. Whether it's citizen journalists who sometimes are very difficult to sort of not really control, but I suppose they do challenge how we do news and reporting with live reporting and things like that. Artificial intelligence, definitely. I think in China, there's like AI newsreaders. The other day I saw that in Zimbabwe, there's a council that has an AI reader for their local news, which was hilarious. But think of how you can also use those to complement your storytelling. Look for people who you think are really admirable figures in journalism or in media, and look at what they're doing. Why do you like it? Do you want to do more things like that? Do you want to work with them? I think people tend to be very open to collaboration, and reach out. Yeah.
Both.
Like, this is us reaching out.
Yeah, reach out.
I would say do both. Build a portfolio, do internships. If you get a chance, do internships. I know a couple of people who've been in the medical field who've transitioned into journalism. Dr. Masi Career, you know. I didn't study journalism full time as well. But I think I thrive best working with and for people, and that's why journalism works for me. Some of us did the careers that we did because we got the grades to do them, yeah? And because at that point, our parents were just like, yeah, she's going to be an engineer, you know? So, but midway you realize I'm better off with people than machines. I'm sorry, Masua. You realize I'm better off with people than I am with machines, and you have to switch. If writing is your passion, I would say follow your passion. It's so fulfilling. It's liberating for me. I do both TV, radio, and online, like writing. But I find my creativity really comes to life when I'm writing, compared to, because I don't have like video to support what I'm doing and all that. So my creativity really comes alive. So start from somewhere. It doesn't have to be on mainstream media. Just start. Just start writing. Share your articles or what you've written with people. Ask for people to critique your writing. Make media buddies, people in the media industry, ask them to critique your writing. Attend the fellowships and the seminars and all these. Build, join groups for media and communications people. And start from there. The good thing about writing is you can do it alongside something else. Yeah? That's one of the pros about writing.
Yes.
You can do it alongside something else. You can do writing while still treating people. You can write about your passions, your everyday passions, you know, without, actually that's an idea for you. I've not seen a doctor who writes about their, like a day in the life of a doctor. Today, this was, you know, definitely protecting their identity, but tell us what you encountered, what stories they tell you and stuff like that, you know? And that's how you start writing, but just start. Bottom line, I would say to all of you is, always remember, you are only as good as your last story. You are only as good as your last story. People will only always remember your last story. They will not remember the story you did. If you do a shoddy story now, that's what they will remember. You are only always as good as your last story. So that means the pressure is also really, really huge as a writer to always be better, to always do better than what you did last time, you know? So... but at the end of the day, it's very, very fulfilling. Yeah.
Let's say if you depend on people viewing your work for you to survive, then how do you stand out? Even if you don't depend on people to view your work or on ads or on anything like that, like you still want a readership for your work. So like, how do you? I think that's the question. How do you follow the trends of what media is becoming? And how do you still stand out, yeah, and retain your audience? Yeah.
I think there's a thing I was saying about how you make those mediums your buddies. It can feel daunting. I still don't quite get TikTok. I tried to during the Kenyan election, and I even opened an account where I just stalk people. But it helps to sort of know, because right now we're dealing with different types of audiences. And young audiences have become such a big equation of that because they have a shorter attention span. I don't think they're stupid. I think that sometimes it's a bit unfair to say that. I have a five-year-old. He knows a lot because I say a lot of stuff in the house, but also he's curious and it's like the best time to get him to be able to just be interested in things. And it's how you also tell people those things that builds their interest without still compromising on the facts, yeah, on what is accurate, on what are the building blocks of telling a story. Those five W's, the one H, that remains the same. How you play around with that media will determine the impact and the reach. So do you want to do, you know, short snippet videos where you tell people about a day in the life of a doctor? you know, for instance, as one way of sort of your entryway. How do you complement the thing that you're very good at? If it's writing, what other media can you put in? If it's, and I think right now websites can do so much. You can do maps, you can do visuals, you can do audio, you can do podcasts. I love podcasts because it allows me to do a passive activity like the laundry or like utensils while listening to something really, really informative. It's also who you bring in. If you're doing a podcast, who are the people who you're having a conversation with? They could be people who have their own audience reach, which then allows you to be able to reach out to more people. It could be the platform you choose to publish your blog on or your article in or your piece of writing. I think one writer who we both know, Kerry Baraka, he's probably one of the handful of long nonfiction writers within the region, and he's managed to write for a number of big magazines and even other smaller publications and a range of things, from newsy things like what do the Kenyan taxes mean, to what it was trekking with for gorillas, was it in Rwanda?
Rwanda.
Yeah, things like that. And it kind of allows you to have range. I think the beauty right now is it is daunting trying to figure out what is the right audience or where. But the good thing is you have so much of a training ground and a huge playground to be able to play with and to use those things and to be a multimedia journalist without even having to go to school for it.
True.
My son makes like short, like my phone is full of his videos. And he knows how to edit and do things with them and make them interesting. So imagine what you can do with your capacity. It's really just about creativity. The trends can be worrying and it can feel like you have to keep up with them. And there's things you do like SEO, you know, what kind of headline do you put to make sure people reach out? I'm not a fan of clickbait, for instance. And I think I managed to work for the most part without having to do clickbait. I do very serious stories. I joke a lot, but I do very dense things. But I think I've been able to build people who actually understand the things that I'm saying. And for me, that's important. Where you find fulfillment, ultimately, will always be even better than whatever you think about audiences, about, you know, do I have to do the TikTok video versus an Instagram reel? It's your fulfillment, especially if you have the liberty to do it. I think just follow that. Mm. Yeah.
And do trial and error. Try if it doesn't work out.
Yeah.
Try another platform. Yeah, it's about nothing is custom. So one thing that may work on this media platform or on X may not work on these other. And you know, there's so many dynamics about how what works for X will not work for Facebook, will not work for TikTok, will not work for all that. To be honest, it's very difficult to fulfill or to generate content as one person across all these platforms. We need to keep up with the trends, but find one or two that work for you, that you are really good at, and just go ham, you know? Just be the best in that, you know? Try and be the best. Because if you divide yourself and want to satisfy all these audiences across all these platforms, you'll burn out, you know? You'll burn out. At the end of the day, you just feel like it's too much, it's too daunting to be a writer, and that's not really what we aim for at the end of the day. It's about fulfillment, it's about just, you know, being creative and feeling good about what you're putting out, yeah?
What do you think about AI? Like, do you think AI can take our jobs? Because if we're wanting to go into writing, we should find out now.
No.
We're going and end up jobless.
No, I don't think so. I think there is the feeling that people are threatened by what it can do, and it's evolved quite a bit. Even I'm trying to keep up with it because I don't understand. There's versions of ChatGPT, for instance, where you feed a certain question, it gives you something that looks almost complete. But human intervention is still so important, and human experience cannot, no matter what I think, be manipulated. You cannot replace a witness account of an event with an AI version or hypothesis of something. The emotion is probably not the same. They do try to, or at least in the learning process, they're learning how to be able to convey that. But it doesn't beat what a person looks like, sounds like, when they're telling you something that has happened to them, whether it's exciting or it's sad. Mm-hmm. So don't think of it as a replacement. I think many media outlets are trying to use it creatively to either figure out how do you channel contents for audiences. So my Instagram feed might be different from her Instagram feed because maybe I look a lot at, I don't know, Vitenges or whatever. But we'll have different things.
Look at Vitenges.
So that algorithm will be giving us the same thing we want because that's what we want. But we're also different in our own ways. I may listen to very different music. My Spotify playlist will do something else. Those are the small things AI is doing. But I don't want to think it's going to be a replacement. No. You still need people behind those stories. You still need human intervention, objectivity as well. In as much as we have our biases, you are able to look at something and say, I'm not sure that's actually right. Let's go back and look at this and look at that. So no, don't think of it as a threat. Think of it as an opportunity to make things slightly easier for you, yes. But not lazy.
Yeah.
You still have to do the work.
I don't think AI will take our jobs. AI is here to make us, to make our job a bit easier. And it's about how you choose to embrace or use AI to make your job easier, not to rely on it 100%, but to make your job easier and to also make you better. Yeah. So it's using it to make you better. And by doing that, I don't think it can ever, ever replace that human connection, like Bev has said. No. So I don't look at AI as a threat or as a negative thing, but as technology that is advancing to just make everything easier for all of us. Yeah. Can you imagine as a doctor in an office full of robots, just, you know, administering the injections, walking like that, giving children hugs, vis-a-vis you doing that? Yeah? Yeah? Exactly. It's just, yeah. It can never replace the human connection.
Okay. I'm guessing we are good.
Yeah. Right? 37 minutes past or 38 past 4. I think this is a good place to wrap it up, yeah?
Yeah.
It's been a great pleasure. Thank you for coming over. Thank you for all the questions. And go forth and prosper as writers.
Yes. We'll be looking out for your stuff.
Yay.
That's your homework.
Yeah.
But thank you all so much and also for engaging with this. Yes. I hope you all the success in writing, because yeah. And the energy as well, because that's one thing that you always consistently need.
Yeah.
And it was good meeting as well.
Yeah. Great. All the best, guys.